Father Richard. The missionary legacy in Alaska is among the probably unique in North America. Gregory Shelikov came in 1784 to put an end to 50 years of what we might today call freelance capitalism. Thanks to Vitus Bering's second voyage, during which his ship wrecked on a small island in the Bering Sea, and out of which his surviving crew built a new boat, thanks to that tragedy came 50 years of sea otter commerce between the Russian Empire and China. You see, sea otters were pretty much unknown in Asia, and they're very hard to get. They're called sea otters for a reason. They live at sea. You can't set traps on land and expect them to stumble into them. That wouldn't work. The only way to get sea otters is to go out on the sea in a kayak and be able to harpoon it. Now, on the waves, in a kayak, there were no Russians in Siberia who had that talent. However, the men who survived Bering's shipwreck came back with sea otter pelts because they had traded for them with the local Unangan Aleut people. And they were a sensation for the simple reason that sea otters have almost no blubber or fat. They stay warm because their fur is so dense and also so incredibly soft. So the Chinese were willing to pay, basically, in modern terms, about $10,000 for a pelt. Now, the cash registers must have been going off all over Siberia once this news hit the newsstands. And the men who were survivors brought their buddies out to the Siberian coast where there was absolutely no wood. And they built leather boats from elk, deer, and moose hide. These, by the way, are tubs that you wouldn't want to cross the Schuylkill River in. And they went to Alaska in them. A little bit crazy, maybe. But there was so much money to be made that ten men could fit into one of these skin boats. And at first they brought with them tea kettles, frying pans, knives, axes, things they thought the indigenous people of North America would appreciate. But they soon made a delightful discovery. The Unangan people valued blue beads more than anything else, the way we might treasure diamonds. So they would trade a sea otter pelt for a blue bead. You paid a nickel for the blue bead, you could make $10,000 profit on the pelt. Such a deal, right? So there was this 50-year freelance capitalist venture where dozens of such skin boats landed on the Aleutian Islands. These men traded with the local people, gave them the blue beads that they treasured so much, and went home with piles, not thousands, but at least hundreds of pelts in their little skin boats. Our history books say that greed motivated all of this. But in fact, that's not really substantiated by the historical record. These guys, those who survived, often made several such voyages, earning up to $500,000 in today's salaries for their pelts, but almost never settled down, bought themselves a nice house, hired a butler and maid to serve them tea at 4 o'clock in the afternoon and bought season tickets to the opera. They weren't those kind of guys. These were frontiersmen, the Davy Crockett, Daniel Boone, Jeremiah Johnson type of guys who loved hunting and fishing, trapping. City life, well, they weren't attracted to it. And while they enjoyed making lots of money, they pretty much squandered it. They gave it away. They built the churches of Irkutsk and the monasteries and the schools and the orphanages. Of course, they partied mightily. And whatever was left, well, they gave that away too, and then they made themselves available for the next voyage back to Alaska. I think the record was 7 times. Now, since each voyage took about 4 years, spending 7 such voyages means they spent about 30 years of their life back and forth, back and forth. As this trade progressed, however, more and more of them kind of got tired of it. They had been traveling to the Aleutian Islands. They had their favorite customers, and they also had their eye on their favorite Unangan sweetheart. So little by little, they said to their buddies, "You guys go back. I'm done with this. I'm moving in. I'm staying here." Now, I'm going to be going out, God willing, to the Aleutian Islands for Holy Week and Pascha this year. The only thing that that kind of bothers me about that is that I know the weather very well. The rain in the Aleutian Islands comes at you horizontally, along with the wind and the fog, and it's not a particularly welcoming climate. So you might wonder, knowing that, why these frontiersmen decided to settle there. But you have to remember, they were coming from Yakutsk, Irkutsk, places known in America only if you play the board game Risk. And you have to remember that these places were 20, 30, and 40 below zero half the year. Therefore, the Aleutian Islands were the closest things to Tahiti they had ever seen. And they loved the place, and they loved the people, and they moved in and built chapels and baptized each other's kids and waited for the priest to show up, which is sort of the history of most of the parishes in Pennsylvania. But here's the important part. We're talking about native spirituality, and that will come in the next chapter. These guys didn't bother about that. They made personal friends, developed personal relationships with these communities. They moved in with their girlfriends and married them legally when the priest did come. And they built chapels in every village. When the missionaries finally did arrive in 1794-95, Father Makarios, the hieromonk assigned to the Aleutian Islands, complained that he had nobody to convert. The entire population was already baptized. There were chapels in every... He had a lot of weddings. He chrismated a lot of children and registered all of those for inheritance purposes. But the mission was begun by the intermarriage of the Siberian people with the Alaskan Native people. That's the first 50 years of our history. And I mention this only to say, as an opening comment, mission work is primarily the work of laity. It's not the priest's job. All of you who are parishioners know that if your parish priest spent more than half of his time working with, dealing with, and interacting with people who weren't even members of your church, there would be a rebellion. Father, that's not your job. We have sick people in the nursing homes. We have church school to operate. We have a choir to recruit or to train. You're supposed to be taking care of our spiritual needs, and that's exactly right. If the church will grow, if there's going to be a missionary outreach, just as it was in the very beginning in the Aleutian Islands, it must be an enterprise primarily spearheaded by the laity. Because it's the laity who meet people out there beyond the boundaries of the parish, who are in a capacity to say, come and see. They don't have to answer all the questions. We're not saying that the laity have to be briefed in every possible missiological obstacle that they might encounter. No. Their job, though, is the outreach. Come on, come see. We have an experience here that's unique. We especially now during Holy Week and Pascha, have an experience that is overwhelmingly joyful, and we want to share that with you. Not to expand our treasury or our membership roles, but because Paschal joy impels us to invite others to participate and to experience that. So that's where the church begins, and it's native Siberian people coming over and intermarrying with, interacting with Alaska Native people. We call them the Russians. They were citizens of the Russian Empire. They spoke the Russian language for the most part. But they weren't ethnically Russians. We had very few Muscovites come to Kodiak. First of all, it's halfway around the world. And secondly, Alaska wasn't mapped. How do you recruit people to come to a place that's not even on the globe? And in fact, if you look at mid-18th century globes produced in Paris and such, the only place on the planet still unmapped and uncharted is Alaska. Now, Gregory Shelikov decided to put an end to all this freelance capitalism. Let's get serious about this fur trade. Let's send ships to Alaska and fill the holds of those ships with thousands of pelts. Let's become millionaires here. Why let these frontiersmen in their skin boats operate indefinitely? And so he got basically a stock company formed. They invested in ships. They built three of them. And in 1784, he set off to Kodiak Island, where he had a military confrontation with the people of Kodiak. They say in the books he brought cannon. They're really something more like a bazooka. They fired cannonballs about the size of a baseball the size of a fist. They couldn't do any serious damage to anybody. They couldn't really kill a lot of folks, but it was for intimidation purposes. We know that Ivan Kuzkov, in the future years after 1784, went with his cannon mounted on the front of his kayak. It already tells you it's not a cannon that like used during the Battle of Gettysburg. It was a very small device. But he would point it at a village. Aleut people have told me this. Point it at a village and say, get out there and hunt. I need 100 pelts from you guys, or I'm going to blow up your smokehouse. Well, the smokehouse is where they had spent the whole summer putting up fish, putting up salmon for the whole winter. Destroying the food supply in autumn leaves the village at least hungry, if not starving. Okay, we'll go. And this is how they, in a sense, extorted the furs in the second chapter of Alaska's written history. Now, Shelikov not only suppressed the Kodiak Aleutic people, but then he went to Europe. He was from Siberia himself. He'd never been to Europe. But he presented himself at the court of Catherine the Great as the conqueror of Kodiak, who had brought 20,000 new citizens into the empire. All of this, by the way, is extremely exaggerated. There weren't more than 200 people. And he also said that he had built a school, he had built a chapel, he had preached the gospel and converted the first Aleutic people, the Kodiak Aleutic people, to Christianity, and he discovered these people were thirsting for the knowledge of God and the holy gospel, and if the Catherine the Great would only knight him as Sir Gregory, and give him, a stipend of maybe 100,000 rubles, and allow him to take a military escort for his own protection back to Kodiak, and what else did he ask for? Oh, yes. A commercial monopoly for all the fur trade in Alaska, Korea, China, and the Philippines while he was at it. There was nothing bashful about Gregory Shelikov. And Catherine turned him down flat. She was reading laissez-faire French economic theory. She didn't want anything to do with monopolies. She pinned a silver something on his chest, gave him two ceremonial silver swords, and dismissed poor Gregory. But Gregory was not a man to take no for an answer. He had petitioned, among other things, for permission to bring a priest to Kodiak Island for the evangelization of the Kodiak Aleutic people. And Catherine liked that idea. She said, just a minute, Gregory, I like this. I give you permission to recruit a priest for Kodiak, but you say here you conquered 20,000 indigenous people and you ask for only one priest? I give you permission to recruit 10 at your own expense. You can imagine how happy Gregory was. And where is he going to find 10 volunteers to go a place that wasn't even mapped? Matushki would not have agreed. So the only viable way to recruit anyone to come to Alaska was to find some monks. Fortunately, not far from St. Petersburg is the Lavra of Valam, a huge monastic complex with hundreds, maybe later on even thousands of monks. He went there and preached his recruitment sermon and attracted exactly 10 volunteers who then came to Alaska. We know the exact date. They arrived in Kodiak September 24th, 1794. It's on the OCA stationery, I think. It's the date that we date the founding of Orthodoxy in the New World. But Gregory Shelikov's idea of transportation was to buy these 10 monks new boots. They walked 8,000 miles across Siberia. It's the longest missionary journey ever undertaken by any Orthodox mission ever in the history of the church. 8,000 miles. And when they got to Kodiak, it was nothing like Shelikov had said. He said he'd built a church, there was a house waiting for them, there was plenty of food and supplies and so forth. None of it was true. So they spent the first six months, in bitter disappointment. But then they wrote in May of 1795 their analysis of what was going on in Kodiak. Part of it went to Shelikov. Funny thing, Mr. Shelikov, you know how we love and respect you, but the kind of settlement you said was being established here, it's nothing like that. And we blame Alexander Baranov, your foreman here, for not implementing, obviously, your instructions. Of course, this may have been simply a diplomatic ploy. But in any case, they have a long list of what's wrong with this place, including how the native people that we've been sent to evangelize are being exploited and terrorized by your company. And we should report this to the governor, but that would get you into trouble and we wouldn't want that. So I'm sure you'll take care of this and rectify the situation. They're very diplomatic in their appeal to Mr. Shelikov, but they've spent 6 months kind of figuring out what is really going on. At the same time, they write a letter back to Valam to report on the missionary possibilities of the situation. They, of course, report how the native people are being abused and exploited, but they say, but we're going to take their side. We've been sent here to evangelize them. We have to be the whistleblowers. And so they report back to their abbot first, pretty much alerting him that there might be trouble and he should know what the real situation is. And then they present an analysis of the Kodiak Aleutic people's spiritual, what would you say, their spiritual ethos, their spiritual philosophy. They've interviewed them. There have been Promyshleniki frontiersmen intermarrying now with the locals. Therefore, they have informants who are married into the tribe who can serve as translators. And they can sit down with the elders of the Aleutic nation and ask them, what is it that you believe in? What do you have a God? Do you believe in a creator? What does your religion teach you about what's right and wrong? And they send back to Valam a fascinating report saying these people believe in one supreme deity. They believe that all human beings are the descendants of a single pair of parents. They have stories of a flood. And they basically have the Ten Commandments. Maybe not to keep the Sabbath day holy, that wouldn't have been part of their vocabulary, but not to lie, not to steal, not to commit adultery, not to... the basic things that human beings all need to do if they're going to live together in harmony. They've got all that. We can work with this. And then little by little, you get a deeper analysis of the spiritual life of the Alaska Native people from the missionaries, both the original ones, St. Herman and Father Yoasaf and Father Yuvanali, and then in the next generation from St. Innocent Veniaminov and especially St. Yakov Netsviatov. Taken all together, I'm not going to go any further into the history, but that's where it all begins. Our missionaries, each time they went into a new area, pretty much did the same thing. They sat down with the elders of that tribe, using the frontiersmen who had already intermarried. The frontiersmen are always there first. They sit down with using the frontiersmen as their liaisons, and they say, now what do these people believe about God? About almost everything. And to do that, there's no cohesive way of doing that with tribal peoples because they don't have a catechism. That what they do have is lots of stories. And it looks something like this. We in the Western world think of history of time moving as a timeline, and I'll do that for convenience sake. We in the modern world are always interested in this end of the line. We want the most up-to-date research, the latest findings, in order to predict what's going to happen next so we can prepare for the future. That's pretty much the focus of all literate societies. You gather information, you read history, you do philosophy, you analyze the economic or the social or the political or the intellectual life of people, and then using all of that, you try to make an intelligent guess as to what's coming next. Our whole orientation is toward the future, toward the end of the timeline. What's unique to traditional peoples throughout the world is their focus is pretty much exclusively centered on the beginnings. It's not just the book of Genesis. It's traditional people everywhere. What do we know about the beginning of the world? Now, oddly enough, there's not a single Alaska Native group that has a creation story. And when the missionaries asked about this, the response was pretty much, well, how would we possibly know how the world was created when we weren't there yet? Our stories begin with the first people. Whatever happened before that, how the earth, then the glaciers and the forests and the tundra and the rivers, mountains came into being, we weren't privy to that. We just know it's here. And now the story begins with us. In a sense, that's sort of sensible, isn't it? I love to point that out to fundamentalist friends that when God said, let there be light, the news media didn't cover it. right? It's not a play-by-play account. Human beings were not there watching on the sidelines applauding God as first, second, third, and fourth day came. We weren't there till the sixth day. So what we believe about the creation of the world is divine revelation, and often misinterpreted and misunderstood. But people often take it as if we were there watching the whole show. Native Alaskan people say, we obviously weren't, and we have no stories about that whatsoever. What we do have is the arrival in Alaska of the first people. And all the tribes seem to have a similar story to this. Raven, the leader of all the animals in most Alaska Native cultures, was walking along the beach one day, and this landing craft, this huge clamshell-shaped vessel, washed ashore.
UFO.
Might as well have been, yes. And the first humans stepped out of it, and Raven was perplexed by these very strange creatures. Raven looked at them from every angle. He circled around and examined them from every side, shaking his head disapprovingly. Stubby little legs. Obviously, you can't run very far or fast. No feathers or wings. Clearly, you can't fly. No claws worth anything. And teeth. Those stubby little things, what good are they? And worst of all, hardly any fur. This is Alaska. We have this thing called winter. It lasts half the year. You're going to freeze. You're never going to make it through winter. You're not even going to make it through the first blizzard. You have no future here. I advise you to get back into that thing and go back to where you came from. That was Raven's suggestion and analysis, but the humans refused. I don't know what I'm going to do with you strange new people, but I'll ask the other animals. So Raven called a convocation of all the Arctic animals. Look what I found on the beach this morning. And the Arctic animals quickly came to the same conclusion. Pathetic. Pitiful. Ridiculous. Doomed. Exactly, Raven said. The animal said, yeah, but Raven, they're kind of cute. Let's keep them. Raven said, I'm not against that. I just don't see how it's going to be practically, logistically possible. I'm open to your suggestions here. So those animals huddled, and they came back with this idea. What if we give these pathetic, pitiful new creatures our feathers and our fur for cover, for clothing? And what if we give them our flesh, our bodies, as meat, as food? Couldn't they survive then? Raven considered this. You know, that just might work. But why would you do that? What's in it for you? And the animal said, we will give these pathetic new creatures our fur and feathers for clothing to cover themselves. And we will give them our bodies, our flesh, as meat for food, in exchange for gratitude and respect. And that's the deal. I think it's the key to understanding Alaska Native cultures. The animals are not inferior beings. Man may be the lord of creation, but he's not the best and brightest. History has proven that to all of us already. In some ways, animals are superior. Animals see things people can't see. Animals hear things people can't hear. Animals smell things people can't smell. Animals know things people don't know. And the traditional people, the tribal peoples of the world say, and they're in cahoots. So if the elk, the deer, the moose, the caribou don't hear the hunters coming with their big ears or smell them coming with their noses, the sparrows tip them off. You can never outsmart them, overpower them, or trick them. How do you ever catch anything? They let you. It's a gift. And for that, we owe them gratitude and respect. Now, you would think if this was a truly religious perception, there would be idols to the various animals. But there never were in Alaska. The gratitude and respect is interwoven into the very way the culture functions. And to the uneducated eye, you wouldn't even notice, for the most part. And there's no books written about this. You just have to live among the people and see it. And that's what St. Herman and the other missionaries did during those first 9 months. And it's the way St. Yakov Netsvetov, who was himself Aleut, was raised. He didn't have to study this. He understood it from within. The other missionaries took the time to come to realize that what people are doing, they're doing it for, in a sense, to maintain this positive, respectful, humble, grateful relationship with the animals whose death was necessary to keep them alive. Another thing that they learned, all the tribes that at least became Orthodox Christians in the later years, they all believed one thing about the beginning. Their stories told them this. They didn't know how it had been created, but they believed that the world was basically a big bowl of water. And the land that they lived on was something like a raft or more like a sponge, filled with water to some extent, but floating in the bowl. And on the top of it was a big dome. And the Yupik words for this are the Imak, the Nuna, and the Kilak. The world has those three levels, the bowl of water, the floating sponge of land, and the superdome on the top. And there's an opening in the Kilak that allowed for, at least originally, a ladder, a rope, a tree, a pole, something like that, some connecting link, like Jacob's ladder, that allowed the first people to descend into the Imak, the sea, the ocean, and communicate with and understand and learn from the fish and the sea mammals that live in the water. They were also, of course, able to communicate with and learn from the animals that lived on the land. Using this ladder, rope, tree, pole, whatever it was, using this, they could also ascend into the sky and learn from the birds and such. And they could even go beyond this world to the world beyond and communicate with the spirits or the angels there. The first people had it made. But all the tribes of the Arctic, whether in Canada, Greenland, Russia, or Alaska, all tell the same story. Not only was there this connection, but the connection very early on got broken. It's the fall of man. The connection, the communion between the divine and the temporal, the creator and the creation is broken very early on, except the story is somewhat different in their stories. This connection was broken not by the first parents, but by the first kids. It amounts to the same thing. But one of the cardinal principles of traditional tribal beliefs is ravens don't have any trouble raising raven chicks to become ravens, and wolves don't have any trouble, it seems, raising wolf cubs to become wolves, and whales don't seem to have any trouble raising whale calves to be whales, but human beings have a dickens of a time raising their children to be human. They don't listen. And this is everybody's story, and all the tribal peoples of Alaska share this perception. It's not so much that the adults are to blame, nearly so much as the kids, who, unlike all the other creatures, do not do what they're told to do. They always want to go off and do it their way. It's not just a Burger King commercial. It's what kids have been like since the beginning of time. And so the first concern here is, how do we raise our kids to be human beings? And there's a good possibility, maybe even a 50-50 chance, that they won't be. That's the danger. So there's another story that I want to tell you. This story is not from the beginning times. It's what ethnographers would call a legend. It ostensibly happened somewhere along the timeline. It's a story that begins very much like hundreds of other Eskimo, Aleut, and Tlingit stories, the three main tribes with whom we're familiar. Once upon a time, a long time ago, there was a grandmother and a grandson living all alone, and they were out of food. That's the beginning that all these others. And the grandmother says to the boy, "Grandson, we're out of food. You're going to have to go hunting." And the boy says, "I'll be right back." Very often in these stories, it's what someone says at the beginning that sets up the rest of the tragedy. He shouldn't have said that. He's acting like, as a competent young man, he can get whatever he wants anytime he wants it. But in the traditional belief, That's arrogant and foolish, because it's not up to him. It's up to the animals whether they're willing to offer themselves and die to keep him alive or not. And the animals, hearing, "I'll be right back," decide to teach this boy a lesson. They hide. The boy walks all day across the tundra. He's exhausted, he's tired. Finally, he just collapses to sit down and rest his weary feet and legs on a tree stump. And just as he's perhaps dozing off, bloop, a villingayagak, a little mouse, a shrew, runs right over his foot, right over his boot. What was that? He grabs a stick and runs after it. He sees what it was, and he clunks that little mouse. Now he's got the catch of the day, a mouse about that size. He told Granny, "I'll be right back." If he walks all night, he can deliver this to her. He knows what she'll do. She'll boil it. They'll have mouse soup for breakfast. And he'll get half a bite of meat, and she'll get the other half of a bite, and they'll both be hungry. And he'll have to walk all the way back out here to resume his hunt tomorrow. It's not worth it. If I bring her this little mouse, she'll laugh at me. "You've been gone all day and all night, and you just bring me..." No. And besides, she's not doing anything. She's sitting in the house, sewing or something. And I'm the one doing all the work. I need this. I need the protein. I need to keep up my strength. I'll eat this little mouse. I'll get something better tomorrow for Grandma. And so it's not a very appetizing snack, but that's all he has to eat at midnight that day. The next morning, he resumes his hunt. He walks most of the day, and he comes to a pond as big as this auditorium. In that pond, there are muskrats. Most of the muskrats flee to the far end of the pond, but one of them feels sorry for this poor, hungry, starving boy and comes paddling toward him. He pulls out an arrow this time and shoots that muskrat. The muskrat's about as big as this marker. It's a decent meal for one person. If he takes it home, he can get to Grandma by tomorrow evening. She'll boil it. And he'll get 5 bites of meat, and she'll get the other 5, and they'll both be starving. It's no use. I'm not going to take this back to Grandma. I need to keep up my strength. You get the idea. He eats the muskrat. The next day, he comes to a pond as big as this campus, a lake, in which there's a beaver dam. Most of the beaver flee to the safety of the beaver house, but one of them feels sorry for this poor, hungry, starving boy, and he comes close enough to be speared. Now the boy has a sizable mammal. A beaver is 30, 40 pounds of meat. But he's so hungry now, having had nothing the first day, a mouse the second day, and only the muskrat the third day, he eats the whole beaver without even thinking of his grandmother. The next day he arrives at the seacoast, and he harpoons a seal. He eats the whole seal. The next day he kills a walrus. He eats the whole walrus. The next day he kills a sea lion. About 3,000 pounds of meat, if you've never seen a sea lion. They're huge. He eats the whole sea lion. Finally, he finds a beached whale the size of that wall, and he eats the whole whale. This stretches him to be the biggest, fattest, ugliest creature that ever lived. He's bigger than any dinosaur that ever clunked around on the planet Earth. And now he's thirsty. So he kneels down and swallows the Bering Sea. This makes him taller than any skyscraper in Philadelphia. But he's finally satisfied. He comes home shaking the ground beneath him. I love doing this in kindergarten with a loudspeaker. He comes to the house, and I neglected to mention that this is not only the Yupik universe, this is the floor plan for any traditional Yupik house. Every house is a microcosm. It has a part of the building dug into the ground, and that part of the building is called the imak. And it has a floor, the nuna, and it has a roof, a domed roof, and the rafters that support that roof are called gilak. The parts of the house and the parts of the world are the same structure and share the same names. So he comes to this house, which is a miniature universe, and he can't fit back into it. And he starts to cry. He's only a 12-year-old kid. Granny's in there, withering away. She hasn't had anything to eat this week. And she calls out to the boy, "Is that you, grandson?" He cries back, "Yes, it's me, Granny." She calls out, "Well, then come in, dear." He replies, "I can't." She asks, "Why not?" The boy replies, "I brought home too much food," which isn't exactly a lie. Grandma says, "That's okay, grandson. You can come in through the roof, through the smoke hole." Through the smoke hole. She hasn't looked out to see his size and shape, but he doesn't dare disobey her. So although the house compared to him is about the size of my shoe compared to me, he plants one huge foot on one side of the house and another huge foot on the opposite side. And then he calls up. She calls to him, "Now jump in, head first." Head first, as if he were a gymnast or a diving champion on a board or on a trampoline. He bends his knees and he throws his whole body up to do a backflip. And as his head descends toward the smoke hole, toward the roof of that house, Grandma inside holds up her magical ivory sewing needle. He passes through the hole, through the eye of that needle, and she transforms him back into his normal size. And out of him comes the ocean, the whale, the sea lion, the walrus, the seal, the beaver. And Grandma traditionally ends the story by saying, "Oh, grandson, what a good provider you are." You could say that's just a silly old Eskimo story, except for this. It's a very serious Eskimo story. It's basically a challenge to the young men on what does it mean to be a human being. We're all, as infants, extraordinarily self-centered and selfish. A baby wants what it wants now and will scream, of course, till he or she gets it. That we were all like that as children, as babies, but little by little, as you mature, you come to realize you can't have it your way all the time. And more than that, you become a human being to the extent that you become the servant of something other than and more important than yourself. If a boy doesn't learn that, he's going to remain, no matter how big and tall, like the boy in the story, and strong he may become, he's still spiritually an infant. And we have, let's face it, in our society, probably millions of boys who grow up thinking it's all about me, what I want, what I like, what gives me pleasure, what I desire, what turns me on, that's all that matters. And never really make the transition to what in a tribal society would be a real man. A real man cares about others. And to this day, when a boy starts to hunt, however young, 7, 8, 9 years old, and he catches his first of anything, because of this story, when a boy catches his first of anything, he eats none of it. It's given away. The animal gives itself to the boy so the boy can be a provider, feeding others, never himself. But in our society, you can grow up, and I even hear this at college and high school counseling and advising sessions. Go in this direction, it'll be good for you. You'll be happier, you'll have more money, you'll have all these benefits. We very seldom try to convince or recruit people to do something because it'll be wonderful for everybody else. But you see, in this story, that's what the boy did. He only cared about himself, and he didn't grow up to be a human being. He grew up to be a monster. So the boy in the story is a paradigm for the boy who, in fact, grew up physically and grew up bodily, but didn't grow up spiritually. Because spiritually, to grow up means to care about others, and even, in fact, to be willing to die for others. And that's a lesson that traditionally Alaska Native peoples were teaching their kids long before they heard the gospel. In that sense, they were ready for it. Because Jesus Christ does nothing for himself. He doesn't become a child in Bethlehem for himself. It would have been more convenient simply to remain in eternity with the Father and the Spirit. He doesn't walk the streets of Nazareth in sandals, stubbing his toe. He doesn't go to the desert to fast for his glory. And he certainly doesn't undergo betrayal, trial, humiliation, torture, crucifixion, death and burial for himself. The Lord does nothing for himself. Now you see, when that gospel was preached to Alaska Native peoples, their response was, wow, a real man. Now add to that what we have in our Orthodox tradition. And we'll be singing this hymn in about 3 weeks. The entrance hymn that we only use, I would say almost regretfully, but we only use it once a year on Holy Saturday. The words are, let all mortal flesh keep silent, and in fear and trembling, pondering nothing earthly minded. For the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords comes to be slain. And then there's the entrance, and we complete it, to give himself as food to the faithful. Can you understand how that resonated when these people who were hunter-gatherers first heard that translation? So what we believe about the animals, and they've been sustaining us for 10,000 years, isn't just a natural pattern within nature. The paradigm is in God. God himself does this. God himself becomes man to offer himself, to be slain, and to give himself as food to the believers. Wow. So what I'm saying, or trying to convey here is, if you understand the cultural background, the context in which the missionaries operated, and they did, they took the time to, if I could figure this out in the 20th century, they had very little, they didn't have any trouble finding it out 200 years ago, when this traditional culture was even more vibrant and was in fact the majority of the people with whom they spoke. The missionaries discovered this and they said, we can build on this. We could take that. There's no reason for us to contradict their stories and tell them that your spiritual life is pagan and evil. And later on, American missionaries would even say demonic and satanic. But they said that without ever learning the language. They said that without ever understanding the people. Now, what gave the missionaries from Russia the inner track on this? And as I reflect on it, it may be accidental, but I believe less and less in accidents as my life continues. It was providential that they walked across Siberia because they were untrained. They didn't have any studies in missiology at Valam. Only one of the ten had a seminary education. But they learned to be missionaries as they walked across Siberia because they learned, well, where else did they stay? They didn't have Hyatts or Marriotts or Hiltons, right? As they walked, where would the monks have stayed? In the next monastery. You walk 15, 20 miles, and there's another monastery. You walk another 15, 20 miles, and each of these monasteries, like concentric circles, like tree rings, had each been founded beyond the boundaries of the empire in its day. And then the empire expanded, and the monks moved further and further into the wilderness, following the frontiersmen. So the frontiersmen are there first, the monks come up quickly behind, and that's how Russia, how Siberia was settled and civilized, if it ever became civilized, that's another story, but you see what I'm saying? So they were reviewing, without consciously knowing it, the missionary expansion across Siberia, as the previous monks that were there before them had experienced it. They certainly talked shop with their brethren about, well, when you were here, how was your monastery founded? And what are the tribes around here? And how did you go about evangelizing them? And they got this missionary pattern. You learn their language. You sit down and talk shop even with their shamans. We'll come to them in a minute. And then you build on that. You present Christianity as the fulfillment of what the people already knew. And that's what St. Herman and the monks did, starting at Kodiak. They say in the first year they baptized 10,000 Kodiak Alotiks. People say, well, that has to be exaggerated. Uh-uh. I beg to. If you approach people this way and say, we're not against what you already have, because they already knew what they already had. We don't have to attack that. We don't have to demean that. We don't have to slander that or criticize it. But we have stories you might be interested in hearing. And it's what Paul Harvey used to do on the radio years ago. We've got the rest of the story. Now, people are interested in the rest of the story, especially if you're not going to come in with a sledgehammer and smash everything they already had. And so, 2 centuries later, I can testify this traditional respect for nature, respect for animals, respect for food is still very much there. When I can remember, just to illustrate this, some years ago, over 20 years ago now, we didn't have TV yet. It's too bad we do now, actually, but we have it now. But we didn't have television. The big village event was, in any village that I remember, something like, they called it the show house, and what was really the movie theater. And they had an old projector that made a lot of noise, made a lot of noises, and they got one or two movies several times a week. So people would go hear that the postmaster had delivered the reel-to-reel films, and people would show up, pay a quarter, buy some popcorn, and stand in a theater one-fourth the size of this cinema where we are. And there was a sheet on the wall, and that was the theater. Well, it was either one of those, I think it was a Three Stooges movie. It was supposed to be a comedy. And at one point or another, it's typical of that genre, somebody got mad at somebody else and hit them in the face with a cream pie. Now, in European, Middle Eastern European culture, that's funny and people laugh. I'm in this room with 200 Yupik Eskimo people, and they saw this probably for the first time in their life. Someone take food, a pie, and throw it into the other guy's face, and 200 people inhaled. And there was this moment of silence. And it was quite clear that they considered this almost sacrilege. How can you treat food that way? And it wasn't, now if it had been an animal, it'd be worse. But even cream pie shocked a 20th century village. How could that be funny? How could you treat food like that? I remember my introduction to this was in a log cabin, a one-room log cabin half the size of this stage. I was living with an elderly couple because I wanted to become a human being. And the word Yupik means real people. Tlingit means the people. Inuit means the people. Unangan means the people. Alutik means the people. Yupik means the real people. And so I was trying to become a real person. And I was living with these people who speak like real people, yuchtun, like people. And we brought to this woman, the woman of my teacher, from a recent hunt, 10 or 12 muskrats. And she was delighted to receive the muskrats. She skinned them and put the little furs on willow branch twigs and behind the wood stove to dry on the floor. And she put all the meat into a big cook pot. And then when I was invited to join the meal, she delivered it to each of us. It was, as we knew, muskrat soup. But the muskrats had not been dismembered. It was vegetables and broth and one muskrat. Needless to say, I didn't know how to approach this with a spoon. The others were there to show me how. They went into their bowls, took the meat from the carcass with their fingers, and ate it. I can do that. Except my high school senior sitting next to me was doing his best to make my initiation into his culture as tough as he could. He kept nudging me with his elbow, pointing at my supper, and whispering into my ear, "Rats, rats, you're eating rats." I remember thinking to myself, "Yeah, but so are you, buddy." And I also remembered thinking, "I don't know either what they put into hot dogs." Thinking this way, I consumed what I thought was the bulk of the muskrat, and my cook, my teacher, came to me and asked me, "Dakudn ka, are you done?" I thought it was done, so I said, "Yes." And she began to remove my bowl. But remember, she was my teacher. When I answered her correctly in her language, she showed real delight. She smiled at me and nodded. She wasn't smiling now. I realized I'd given an incorrect answer. Watching her, I quickly changed my mind. Daksaita, I'm not done yet. And she returned my ball and retreated. The problem was I didn't know why I wasn't done yet. Everybody else was doing something for which there is no English word. That's when you really know you've gone over the cultural boundary. You've gone into another way of seeing the world, or often what I call, you're playing a different ball game here. Because as I looked around the table, everybody was still busy. They were separating every little bone from every other bone. And wherever there was the tiniest little speck of meat, they were doing their best to consume that. Now, the word for this in Yupik is bukuk. To bukuk means to assiduously and carefully consume all the meat from the bones of an animal so that none of it will be wasted as a sign of gratitude and respect for the animal that died to feed you. And bukuking is noisy and messy. You separate every little bone and then you get 10 people at the dinner table. Emily Post would not approve. But we're not doing that ball game. We're doing the Yupik ball game here. It's a different set of rules. So I did my best to bukuk. And the cook returned, Nu tan ka takutin. Now you're done, aren't you? Not so confident the second time around, I looked up at her and said hesitantly, E. And she said, E. That's how you learn, right? I'm sure our missionaries had the same experience. The idea here is that the life in the animal and the life in us is the same reality. The outer shape is different, but the inner sacred presence is the same reality. The life in the animal and the life in us is the same, and it has to be treated with care, with reverence, respect. And it's illustrated in art. I don't think we have any examples of this upstairs in the exhibit, but we do have it here and there. There are some examples in Tlingit art. The Tlingits live in a forest and they had lots of wood, so they did a lot of wonderful wood carving. They are the totem pole carvers. But the masks that they make often have an exterior and then an interior mask. There's the outer shape of an animal, whatever it may be, but the mask itself opens and the inner mask is a human face. The message is clear. The life in the animal and the life in a human being is the same reality. Yupik Eskimos have a different way. They make a mask that shows the entire face of the animal, but one eye is a human face. The eye is called its yua. It's the life force that makes it to be alive. And that which makes it to be alive is that sacred presence that must be treated with care, with gratitude, with respect, with humility. So now, Here's another theological point. Jesus Christ is the life of the world. God so loved the world that he sent his son. A few weeks ago on the feast of, Sunday of Orthodoxy, we venerate your most pure image and so forth, for you came to save the world. This is something lost, tragically, in translation. Because I think the way most English-speaking people interpret that when we say Jesus came, well, John 3:16, he so loved the world, right, that he sent his son. In all of those cases, the word for world is not what people might think. The Greeks have several words for world, but one of them, oikoumeni, means the people of the world, the inhabited world, the human beings on the planet. But in none of those cases is the word oikoumene. Instead, where John the theologian wrote, for God so loved the world, he didn't write, for God so loved the people of the world, the oikoumene. He wrote, for God so loves the cosmos, the whole creation. Christ comes to bless, to sanctify, to restore, to purify, to transfigure the creation, not just the people. Here's something else that resonates with Alaskan Native people, right? Your spiritual life is nourished by your relationship to the environment and to the way you treat the environment. And if you treat everything that's alive with reverence, with gratitude, with respect, that could be dismissed in some circles as a pagan idea. But not if you read the New Testament in the original Greek. And then you go forth in January, where our rivers are all frozen, and invoke God's blessing on that lake or that river or that ocean. You see how that resonates with our people? Certainly in a way that it might not, as long as we're doing holy water, blessing, great blessing of water over a big tub or some mini tubs of water, or like I saw in Mexico, lots of bottled water. Well, it's fine to bless all that because you can drink it, you can bless your house with it and all the rest, but you see, we're sort of missing the boat if we're not leaving the church and blessing the local lake. And we always do this in Alaska, cold as it may be. You have to go out and bless that river out of which you pull your salmon, out of which you fish in winter through the ice. The river that provides you with everything. The water that provides you with everything. And this sense of the essential sacredness of nature is so close to the Alaska Native spirit. And it is, if you think of it, in the liturgical life of our church. But we often think of it as just a quaint custom that we use precisely for our own sanctification and blessing. But it's really for the sanctification and blessing of the creation that God so loved. And I think this is another point that resonates very much with Alaska Native peoples. In other words, I'm saying the missionaries understood this, and so they blessed water a lot. In some villages, the priest would bless water several times a year and then go in procession around the whole village and bless the whole village. It needed to be purified. It's not so much that it needs to be purified and cleansed, it's just that we constantly, in our fallen, sinful state, need to be reminded of its inherent sacredness and that we should be living accordingly in our homes and in that community. But you see, we have this as a tool, so to speak, as a pastoral, and we often fail. Now, here in this part of the world, we're not living in coherent and small enough Orthodox communities where you could make such a procession and bless all the houses. But there, it's part of daily life. And our missionaries saw this as another way of building those bridges. So we have here, I'm going to take this down. We have here, or rip it off maybe. In the beginning, we have the sacred stories. I'll call them sacred stories. Anthropologists now call them myths. But myth sounds like something that's not true. Sacred stories about the origins. The sacred stories have in them the origins, the patterns, the paradigms, the structures of the way the world is and has always been. Now, there aren't many of those kind of stories. Those are the ones that are at the beginning of the timeline. Besides that, we have the legends. And the legends are like the ones I told you already, the Eye of the Needle story. They reinforce the ideas that from the beginning stories. In other words, the basic notion that the world is in that kind of shape, and that's why we build our houses in that same shape, and that's how we behave inside those houses. It's interesting, the missionaries saw that when someone died in a Kodiak Alutiiq house, they never took them out the door. They either had to bury them in the imak because they were making the passage from the earth, the surface of the earth, to the spirit world below, or they had to take the body out through the roof because they're making the passage from our plane of being to the spirit world above. The passage out the door is something different. And I hope I don't embarrass her, but I learned this from my wife. We have four kids. During all her pregnancies, I'm sure she was doing this, but during the first one, I missed it. I didn't even notice. What was she doing? She was getting up early and leaving the house. It's a perfectly, like I said, you could miss these behaviors unless you're watching closely. Getting up early and leaving the house. Well, she was doing this before Anastasia was born, but she was born in October. So my wife was getting up early and leaving the house in September, August, July, June, May. It's sunny and warm. You don't even notice that someone's getting up early and leaving. But Ekaterina, our second daughter, was born in January. So she was getting up early and leaving the house in January, December, November, the coldest, darkest months of the year. One morning as she was coming in, I asked her, "Where'd you go?" "Out." "Yeah, why?" "It's what we do." I'm thinking, we who? You pick women. Okay. And then I was stumped. I didn't know what else to ask. So I had to drop the line of inquiry. 6 months later, I was the graduation speaker at a UPIC boarding school. And as I sat down at the dinner table, I was surrounded by four or five, maybe even six or seven, UPIC teenage boys. And they didn't believe that I could talk like a human being. They were going to give me a culture quiz. So as I sat down, they asked me, Kituzit, who are you? I told them my UPIC name, Atachtayagak. It means the little drifter, by the way, and it's a name I live up to. Chamyunguzit, what village are you from? I wasn't going to say Allentown, Pennsylvania, and blow my cover. So I sidestepped that question and said, Aipakakwihlugamyunguk, my wife is from the village of Kwihluk. They were satisfied. Then they asked me this question, Nakinanshuzit. Literally, from where did you exit? It wasn't the follow-up question I was expecting. Where did I had just come from the dorm, so I said, Inagavigamuk, from the place where you lie down. Can't be right. I asked them to repeat the question. They said it slower and louder. Naken Anshozet, doesn't help. I came out of the airplane before that. Tingsutmuk, from the airplane. No, that can't be. Finally, I had to surrender. Dahingstikatamchi, I can't understand you. They switched to English. Where were you born? Oh, well, not in the dorm or the airplane, that was clear. But this triggered an association. I had to go back to my wife and ask. Now, I know, dear, we pursued this conversation some time ago, but I didn't. When you get up in the morning, early, in pregnancy, and leave the house, is there something special you have to do? And again, my wife is thinking, like, doesn't everybody know this? You see, a culture is like, a culture is the way you see the world. It's like going into a shed on a sunny day. When you first enter the shed, you can't see anything. It's too dark. What you can clearly see are the shafts of light that come through the cracks in the roof and illuminate in front of you a shaft of sunlight that comes all the way down to the floor. You can look at the sunlight, and you can see every particle of dust suspended there in that brightness. But there's another way of experiencing the light, and that's to step into the shed and look out along that light. Everything changes. When you're in the beam of light, you see the sun 93 million miles away. You see the blue sky. You see white clouds. You see birds, possibly, or insects. And you see the tree that kind of hovers over that corner of the shed. But while you're in the beam of light, you cannot see the beam of light. Once you've stepped into the beam of light, the shed disappears, and the beam of light disappears. That's your culture. It's the beam of light along which you see the world. My wife is in her beam of light. The way she sees it, everything there is obvious. I'm looking at her beam of light. I can't see what she's seeing, you see? Now, I'm trying to get in there. That's why I'm asking these questions. Okay, it's obvious to you, I'm thinking, but I don't get it. When you get up early and you wash and you dress and you leave the house, is there something special you have to do? Or is there something special about how you go out? And she's looking like, well, of course. Can't you see what I see? I can't see it. When she explains to me, an expectant mother gets up early and leaves the house intentionally, consciously, passing through the doorway, somewhat bent forward. She must pass through the exit of the house head first, and never linger in the doorway, head first without stopping, for 9 months. Ladies, gentlemen, you're all old enough to know this. What is she enacting for 9 months? Baby? We know kids don't listen. You tell them and tell them, they do it their way. We don't want that to happen now. There's the right, healthy way to be born, head first and directly. Right. The house, I could put this back, is a womb. And the passage from inside to outside is birth. And you pass through that opening, through that exit, deliberately. Life is, one could say, in these traditional cultures, ritualized. You don't do it a new innovative way. You do it the way we always have. And that's what makes it meaningful. Not innovative. It might not be the quickest, easiest, or fastest way to do it. That's beside the point. We're not interested in the quickest, fastest, labor-saving way of doing something. We're looking at the most meaningful way to live. So as I imagine it, my wife, the last time was 1982, was going out the door, head first without stopping for those 9 months. Is that a behavior she invented? Clearly not. She learned it from her mother. Did her mother invent it? No. She learned it from her mother. And so the belief is that this is what the first mother taught the first daughter. And we've been doing it this way since the beginning of the history of the world. It's as if time does move forward generation to generation, but it also returns constantly to its origins, to the origin, to the way it was done in the beginning, and we're all still doing it exactly that way. And that puts us all in solidarity with all our ancestors throughout chronological time. It also puts us in solidarity with all women who are currently expecting. There's a word for this kind of time. The Greeks had it. We don't have it in English. It's keros, meaningful time, sacred time. It's not doing it in some new, exciting, innovative way that has never been done before. It's just the opposite. It's the way we've always done it. And it's the way we've always done it puts us in solidarity precisely with all our ancestors. It also puts us in solidarity with all our contemporaries. And that's what we Orthodox do when we celebrate the liturgy. We don't make up a new one. On this coming Sunday, we will sing the same tropars that everybody else is singing, and we'll do it the way it was done 100 years ago, 500 years ago, and 1,000 years ago. That's keros. The deacon says to the priest in Greek at the beginning of the liturgy, keros estin. It's keros now. He's not saying chronos estin, as if he was pointing to his watch and saying, Father, it's time to start. It could be misinterpreted that way, but that's really not what he's saying. He's saying it's time for us to leave chronological time behind and now do it the way we've always done it. My wife's example of going out the door, it only takes her a couple of seconds to do that, the way we've always done it, is a moment of keros, meaningful time. And this is where I think our missionaries really hit the nail on the head. They understood this because even if they didn't know Greek, in our liturgical tradition, we have this sense that there's chronological time that just goes on ticking like the Timex watches. And then there's keros, which interrupts all that, a kind of sacred time where we do things in a meaningful way that puts us in harmony with, spiritually, our ancestors, in the case of the church, back to the Last Supper, the upper room. Because we're not making up new words for Jesus Christ. We're going to say, take, eat, this is my body, and drink of this, all of you, at every liturgy. Now, that could say, this is boring, it's the same thing every Sunday. That's a modern chronological way of seeing it. And when's this going to be over would be the follow-up, right? When at the Mass, the Roman Catholic Mass or the Orthodox liturgy, it's not a new, exciting, never seen before event. It's the way we've always done it because we're entering into meaningful time. When I talk to Native people about this, I say, the way I see your life and your beam of light, it's not work and play the way it is for us. We divide our time, the chronos, the time of our life, between on the job, off the job. We're either at work or we have free time, right? And all our life is scheduled that way. We're either on the job or off the job, we're at labor or at leisure. My perception of Alaska Native people and traditional tribal peoples around the world is that's not how they see or experience time. We're either doing something meaningful, and if we're doing it meaningfully, we're doing it the way it's always been done. You can come in and say, I know a quicker, faster way to do that, and they'll say, or at least they'll think, so what? Why would we want to break the chain? I mean, this is where I learned it myself. I was making suggestions in an Aleutic village. There's a faster, easier way to do this. And they look at me, but why would we want that? This is the way we've always done it. Now, that sounds like a real stupid response until you realize the way we've always done it is the meaningful way. And how much we do in the church is exactly that. It's not some, it can't be some new exciting way. The Jewish Passover, it's in Hebrew even if you don't speak Hebrew, because that's the way we've done it for 5,000 years. It doesn't mean you can't translate parts of the Seder into English, but it won't be the same unless you're doing something in the way we've always done it. And this is certainly a trait in all spiritual life, and our missionaries kind of stumbled into this as well. So back to my chart, I want to finish up soon. We have the sacred stories which are from the beginning, and then we have the legends that reinforce it. Now, out of both the sacred stories and the legends, every tribe has art. Carvings, not just in a religious sense, it's everyday stuff. You would you carve your bowls in the shape of the animals to whom you want to show respect. You scrimshaw your harpoons and your knives and your weapons with the, you carve them in the shape of or decorate them with the pictures of precisely those animals, and you make them as beautiful as possible. The ladles, the serving spoons, anything that's going to come in contact with the animal is made almost like a work of art. Because they know. They know that you've taken the time to make it as beautiful as possible as a sign of gratitude and respect. We do the same thing in the church, by the way, making everything as beautiful as we can as a sign of gratitude, respect, humility, and the rest, art. And the art, therefore, for them is not liturgical versus everyday. It's the same thing. Art and music. There's a lot of songs and a lot of art that refer back to the legends and the sacred stories. In fact, there's more songs than there are stories. But we shouldn't be surprised at that. In our culture, the nativity story, for example, in Matthew and Luke, aren't really very long. Matthew has the kings and Luke has the shepherds, and when you put it all together, you get 10,000 Christmas carols. Right? The stories inspire art and music and ceremony, but they all come out of and are based on and derived from the sacred stories or the legends. And people will sing the song and assume that everybody there knows the story out of which it came. What's really confusing sometimes about Alaska Native, especially Tlingit songs, is that they often don't have any intelligible words. So you know what they're celebrating because it's that holiday, but when you ask the people who are singing it, what does that mean? They say, well, actually, it doesn't mean anything. Now, how can you have a song that doesn't mean anything and you sing it every year on this holiday? Well, think for a minute. We have songs like that too. I don't have to sing it. I can just recite the nonsense syllables to fa la 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 la, la 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 la, and ask you, what holiday is that? And a second grader will tell you, well, that's Christmas. Well, what does fa la 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 have to do with Christmas? Actually, nothing at all. But we immediately make that association. Because when you're part of that culture, you get it. And a Tlingit kid can hear the song of Kachachkuch, which has no intelligible words in it, and immediately say, but that's Kachachkuk's song, a hero from centuries ago. But you see what I'm saying? Once you get the stories and the legends, you get art, music, song, and dance, and ceremony that derive from all of that, because that's how you celebrate and keep the stories alive. Just reading the stories by themselves or reciting the stories gets, as kids today very often say, boring. But you make it alive by celebrating it with song, dance, ceremony. And then finally, in these cultures, there was the shaman. The shaman, it's believed, is someone who, often by accident, has descended into the sea, the water, or to put it another way, into the lower regions, where the human beings originally had access, but we've lost our possibility to go there. Or the shaman has been, as it were, struck by lightning or fallen from a cliff. And there's a word for this in modern culture. A shaman is a person who has had an out-of-the-body experience. They've died. And then, of course, revived. If they only died, they'd just be a corpse, and that would be the end of them. But the shaman is someone, it's believed, Their spirit, their soul, the yua, the life force in them, has at least temporarily left their body and then returned to it. It's not a resurrection, but it's a resuscitation. And where did their spirit, their soul, their yua go while it was gone? It either went into the spirit world below, or it went up into the spirit world above. And then when it came back, the shaman has done, it's believed in traditional cultures, what our ancestors in the beginning could have done, but where the rest of us mere mortals can't do it. Well, we'll all do it sooner or later, but we call it death. The shaman has had the out-of-the-body experience, the experience of dying and then returning, and when the shaman, he or she, could be male or female, when they've returned, they have abilities and insights that they didn't have before they've had this out-of-the-body experience, this near-death or actual death experience. So now, since they've done what the first people did, they've, not completely, but they've been to the spirit world above or the spirit world below, and I should have mentioned, the spirit world below is not hell, and the spirit world above is not heaven. There are spirits hostile to human beings on all levels, and there are spirits friendly to human beings on all levels. If they meet a friendly spirit who can guide them, they survive this ordeal, and they come back to life. In any case, the shaman is one, it's believed, has recaptured the lost abilities that everyone believes the first people actually had. Not 100%, and this gives them prophetic powers and abilities, and also healing powers and abilities. So the shaman is the prophet and healer of his people. On Kodiak Island, the missionaries reported during the baptism of the first 10,000 people that the shamans did not themselves submit immediately to baptism, but they told their villagers to go meet the missionaries and listen to their stories and do as they were told. So it was the shamans who actually, you could say, performed the ministry of John the Baptist among the Kodiak Aleutic people. I must decrease, they must increase. Go listen to their stories and do as they instruct. And so the people, it was a smooth transition though, you see, from their shamanistic path to the Christian gospel. For all of these reasons that I'm trying to cite here, they became Orthodox Christians, but they didn't see that it required them to renounce most of the beliefs they already had. They could receive Christianity, they could receive the gospel as an addition to their repertoire. And it was the shamans themselves who encouraged this. In fact, we know in 1832, St. Innocent Veniaminov, paddling along the Aleutian archipelago, it's 1,000 miles long and probably 5,000 miles of coastline, because even though the islands are very small, they have very jagged, very intricate coastlines. So he lands on this island, and the whole village is waiting for him in their best kamalekas, their best clothing. How did you know I was coming even at all, let alone today? And how did you know I would be arriving at this particular inlet? And the people said, our shaman told us. Then they went to the village and he met a woman who had been dying and the shaman had healed her. Other people in the village said that they were starving last winter and the shaman told them where to find a beached whale, and finding that meat saved them from starvation. Clearly the shaman knew something. So John Veniaminov, the future Saint Innocent, said, I'd like to meet your shaman. Will he come and visit me? The shaman came. They called him old, but he wasn't 69, which is how old I am. So he was still a young man. He came to Veniaminov, presented himself. Saint Innocent began interrogating him. How do you know what you know? My spirits tell me. What kind of spirits? What do they look like? And the shaman described spirits, but they appeared more in angelic form. Do they ask you to worship them? Never, they forbid that. What do they teach you? The same as you. Will they appear to me? I'll check. He came back the next day and said, my spirits agree to appear to you, but they want to know why you want to see them. Do you think they're demons? Veniaminov at this point said, everything indicates these are angels. But who am I to meet with angels? I better check with my bishop first. He wrote a letter to his bishop, which is why we know all of this. The bishop was back in Irkutsk, Siberia. It took a year from Exactly. It took a year for the letter to get there. It took another year for the letter to get back. The letter said, go ahead, I'm interested, tell me more. But by the time Yuan Veniaminov got to that island again, the shaman had died. I cite this only to indicate that the missionaries who lived in Siberia were first of all familiar with shamans. They knew something about this phenomenon, and that while they knew that some shamans did nasty things and did kind of black magic and such, they also knew that there were shamans who were authentic healers and prophets and helped their people. So you had to sit down and talk shop with the shaman first to find out what kind of shaman you were dealing with. It was on a case-by-case basis. When the Americans took over Alaska, they immediately decided that all shamans are in league with the devil, and the shamans had to be arrested and suppressed. I'm not saying that the Russians were all that more tolerant, but they were willing to give the shaman the benefit of a doubt that this might be one of the good guys. And on Kodiak Island, it's all the testimony of the Kodiak Aleutic people, their shamans encouraged them to be baptized. And the shaman in the Aleutian Islands I just cited was almost clearly in communication with angels, by all accounts. So the shaman. Now, to conclude, what our missionaries were able to do, as I've been able to assess it, was to say to the people, basically, you have these stories of origins that contain the paradigms and the structures of the universe and the sort of the way the world is and why it is the way it is, the basic origin stories. We have those too. And we also have stories that give us the paradigm, the ideal, the way to become a real human being. And it's not a bunch of stories, it's a person, Jesus Christ. And if you imitate him and do as he taught, and most importantly, act as he acted, you too will become a real person. You see how that made perfect sense to these guys? And then you could begin translating the Gospels and teaching them what Jesus Christ was really like. But the basic structure of their spiritual life was not disrupted or overthrown. It was preserved so they could make a speedy transition to the Christian faith. And then the legends in Christianity are the lives of saints. These are the stories of the people who have actually followed this program and succeeded at it. And the art and music, well, we have plenty of stuff. We have our hymnography, and we have our icons, and we have our architecture, which is very similar in traditional Orthodox architecture to the traditional buildings that the people already had. The big dome over the whole top, the whole universe being sanctified. And then, of course, we have our feasts and the sacraments of the church to complete what you had before in ceremonial life. Finally, and this is the surprise, the missionaries could not have ever predicted or forced this issue, they had among them one monk who was a prophet and a healer. And this is what you could say congealed the whole story and made it real to the local people, because Father Herman became both prophet and healer in its Christian expression. He's the one who healed the sick, and people came to his grave after his death, which no shaman ever did. Most of Father Herman's miracles occurred posthumously. He did nurse the sick during epidemics at great risk to his own health, but there's no miracles of healing that we know of during his life. But because people revered him as the whistleblower, as the one who wrote the letters back to Russia, complaining about the mistreatment of the Aleutic people, for that reason alone, they venerated him as a kind of hero. And after he died, they buried him in the cave that he himself had dug. And on the 100th anniversary of his arrival, they built a chapel over his grave. And then this became a place of pilgrimage. No outside people encouraged this. It wasn't something that the church administration someplace else ordered the people to do. It was a complete grassroots movement where the people themselves venerated him as a holy man, as a saint, as a whistleblower who stood up for them and endured harassment and even 3 assassination attempts. We shouldn't think that Father Herman went to Spruce Island because he needed a quiet place to pray. He went to Spruce Island because they tried to kill him in Kodiak. And of course, the Aleutic people knew that. So they venerated him for some reasons that we don't even mention in our liturgical celebrations, except for one line in the Chopar, intercessor and defender of the oppressed. but nothing else in our liturgical celebration of Father Herman tells you who's oppressing whom. But it's there in one line of one conduct or one tropar. But otherwise, you know, it's kind of like missing from our veneration of Father Herman. But it's critical to the reason the Aleutic people venerated him as a saint, as a courageous one who stood up for their rights and for was morally and ethically true then and now. And then they built this chapel. And then after that chapel was built and people came there to pray on a regular basis, that's when the healing miracles began. People take a little bit of the earth that had covered his grave, his coffin, and anointed their sick children, and the children miraculously recovered. I knew people like this when I first went to Alaska. The mayor of our town said, I was dying. He lived on Spruce Island, but 8 miles from Monk's Lagoon, people made a pilgrimage. They prayed at Father Herman's grave. They took some of the spring water from the holy spring. They took some of the just a handful of dirt from that had covered his coffin. They brought it back to the village. They made a mud pack and put it on his chest. And the boy who was dying of pneumonia, given up as hopeless by the doctors, recovered. And you hear over and over again the miraculous healings attributed to proximity to Father Herman. The dirt that covered his coffin, not even his coffin, but the dirt that covered it. It's as if holiness is a kind of radiation. You know, people go to radiation treatment and they expect to be healed, but you've got to be careful with radiation. Too much will kill you. Just the right amount will heal you, but it's a touchy thing. That's how the church treats holiness. You've got to be careful with it. And I think it's just another quick footnote, but it's why we have the 40-day prayers for women. The woman needs to be purified not because she did something wrong or has been defiled. She needs to be purified because she's just had an overdose of holiness. She's radioactive. You gotta clean her up before she can come back into normal society. She's so sacred that she needs to be purified. We think of purification as only when somebody's been defiled or polluted. It's just the opposite, however, and it can happen either way, both in the Bible and in the tradition of the church. Father Herman's bones radiated, one could say, holiness to the point where anything that came in touch with him also had those healing properties long after his death. No shaman ever did that. So you see how his life and even his death corroborated the Christian gospel among the Alaska Native people. And everyone knowing this, it's undeniable. Even sectarians who were very critical of the Orthodox Church and its mission and its support of Native cultures and languages could not deny, even before or after his canonization, that the miracles are real. They've known people who have drunk some of that water from the sacred spring or been anointed with that earth. And it's so many hundreds of people over the years. It's simply unquestionable. One miracle after the other in nearly every family on the island. No wonder he's canonized. But you see, there's a structure here that I'm trying to summarize. They had sacred stories, so do we, and ours are written down. So they begin in the next generation to develop a writing system, an orthography for Kodiak Aleutic, and they publish the gospel in the people's language. Before, you had to wait for the elders to get around to telling the story whenever they got around to it. You had to beg grandpa to tell you the story, and you were dependent on that. Now anyone who becomes literate can read the story anytime they want. That's amazing. Literacy caught on in the Aleutian Islands and Kodiak, and we're told that by the middle of the 19th century, the literacy rate among Alaska Native peoples was higher than in European Russia. They were thirsty for these stories. They were eager to have access to these stories, and these were the sacred stories in the past that had to be told and now could be read. So literacy became a phenomenon because it was the sacred stories. And then what else did St. Innocent publish? A Bible storybook with the lives of saints. It's precisely to fulfill in the Christian form what the legends had done in the pre-Christian form. And in the next generation, they are painting their own icons on sail canvas from the ships. They're taking the sails off the ships to paint icons on for their homes and churches. So you see, and then they're composing their own music and certainly singing in both their own language and in Slavonic. So all of this is fulfilled in the Christian expression without doing radical violence to what was there before. And finally, I would say, in my own understanding, my going to Alaska, I've come to realize and appreciate so many things that were already there in our tradition, but you didn't really take all that seriously. Let the heavens rejoice, let the earth be glad. You start reading the praises, for example, at the end of all my, and it's the whole earth celebrating, all of nature celebrating. We do this wonderfully on Holy Saturday, praising the sun and moon, shining stars, frost and snows. Everybody used to look at me at seminary, frost and snows. But you see, it's true. It's not just poetic license. The whole world does participate. And then what we're singing in Great Lent, the hymn to the Theotokos. In thee all creation rejoices. It's not just poetic hyperbole. It's real. The you are in the plants, in the grass, in the trees, in the daffodils, and in the forsythia. The thing that makes them all alive is Christ. We have this, the theology of Maximus the Confessor and the whole notion of the lowercase word logi in the plural and Christ as the logos to back up that. You see how this resonates with Alaskan Native peoples? But I also believe it should resonate with us. We've sent a mission to Alaska for the last 220 years. But there's also now, I believe, a mission from Alaska. Because there are things that now that the Native people of Alaska have embraced the faith and it's become indigenized, they have things to highlight, not to change, not to alter, not to retranslate or redefine, but things that we have overlooked in our own tradition that suddenly become so important and so meaningful to us in a way that it wouldn't have been if we hadn't entered into a dialogue with them. Certainly the missionaries brought them the true faith, and they've been Orthodox Christians now for 200 years, and we can take some kind of pride in that. But on the other hand, I believe that they have a lot to teach us, and that conversation is only beginning. But for that, I give thanks to you for being here tonight so that we can continue that dialogue and that discussion. Thank you for being here this evening. So the floor is open for any questions, comments, or criticisms, as you may wish.
Does anyone have any questions?
You.
Yes, certainly.
Yes, Father Michael, I have questions like for all fathers here.
Oh.
I'm an animal lover myself, and I really like the way you presented that the natives really respect and love animals. But also, I hear now there's more and more Russian Orthodox priests have this theory that, yes, animals have souls, and they have the theory that they might go to heaven. It's still unknown. So, like, as they say, I have a question. What do you think, fathers, about the animals?
I would say the word soul is a little bit of a problem. But if we believe that the church is here to sanctify the whole of creation, then heaven is not someplace so far away that we have to jump to it. Heaven is this world renewed in the image of Christ's resurrected body. Christ came back not just in spirit. He came back with the wounds still in his hands. He says to Thomas, I'm not a ghost. A ghost doesn't have flesh and blood. But his body was immortal now. It couldn't be held in by the sealed tomb. It couldn't be shut out by the locked doors and so forth. That's the reality of the world to come. And that reality is not just for human beings, it's for the whole creation. So in that sense, if everything that's alive and blessed by God in the beginning is being blessed and transformed and ultimately saved, then that includes the plants, the animals, the mountains, the lakes. That's why they're all rejoicing, why all creation is rejoicing, because all creation is involved in this and not just the people. If heaven, in other words, heaven is not some other place that we have to jump to, leap to, or escape to. Heaven is this world, as Christ says in the book of Revelation, made new. So, you know, I had my doubts about cats, but as my bishop once said, cats were worshipped in Egypt, and they have never forgotten it. But I'm only being facetious there. No, cats too. The animals that we have tragically killed off and made extinct. If we believe in In the transformation and the resurrection, it includes them too. It's not that we send them to heaven and they have to have souls. They were living things, and there you are, the logos in them with a lowercase l, the word in them, the life force in them, was a variation on the theme Jesus Christ, the life of the world. So I would say, you know, to answer your question, all the animals and all and the whole of creation is being renewed. But I don't, but I would be hesitant to use the word soul.
On your other flip chart, the previous one, you were talking about heteros.
Yes.
So how does that, how do they, in today, 21st century America, or
yeah,
the world, how do they, I don't want to say rationalize, but how do you manage that?
How do you make sense? Well, you see, you could dismiss them as simply habits or customs. Or I saw one list of, in Quinahawk or Togiak, superstitions. The way you're supposed to do things, you know, like don't walk under a ladder, or don't let throw salt over your shoulder, whatever those things. All of those things are very momentary, doesn't take very long to do them, things. But running your life that way is still quite possible. There's the right way to sleep in the bed and the right side to get out of. What does it include? It includes, as a matter of, not by clock time, but as a matter of routine, always saying your prayers at a certain time every day. Because that's what we've always done and that's what we always do. So the people get out of bed, they know what to do. They have to put some wood in the fire to get the house warm, and they get dressed, and then the next thing they do is light the lampada and pray. It doesn't have anything to do with the time of day on the clock. It's just what we do in that sequence, just like putting on your pants and then tying your shoes, putting on your coat, whatever it is. It's the orderly sequence of the things you do every day, day in and day out. You do it maybe as a matter of routine, maybe as a matter of habit, but those are all flashes of keros.
No, I get the impression it's very deliberate.
Oh yeah, it is, but I mean it's very deliberate in a very habitual way. You see what I'm saying? Because you're not going to change the routine. But now a pregnant woman will, because she doesn't necessarily have to get up that early and leave the house. But now that she's expecting, she's going to do that. So there are ritual actions that are inserted according to how old you are and what your health and condition is. But yeah, it is very conscious on one hand, but you have to stop and ask someone, why'd you do it? Well, it's like Orthodox making the sign of the cross before you eat. We just do it. you're not conscious about all the Trinitarian theology that involves every time you do it, but it's still there in kind of inherently. But I'm just saying that it's a natural thing. You caught a moose. There's the right way to kill it. There's the right way to butcher it. There's the right way to treat the hide, the fur. There's the right way to butcher the meat. There's the right way to cook the meat. There's the right way to eat the meat. There's the right way to deal with the bones that are left over for which you have no practical use. But all of those rituals have to be fulfilled or the animal will be unhappy to say, and you won't get another moose for another 5 years because you weren't careful, humble, grateful, respectful, and so forth. So that's why they could be called taboos or what did I call them before? Superstitions. But I would never denigrate them like that. I think these are simply ways in which people have traditionally and for centuries entered into the keros of their lives. But people could look at it and say, oh, it's just a silly superstition. Okay, and then the missionary comes to town and say, why do you people still do these things? It's all stupid, it's all backward. In fact, it's blasphemy or whatever. Our missionaries at least never took that position. And I think we can take a certain pride in that. But it wasn't because they were so bright and brilliant, it's because they walked across Siberia and learned those things. So thank goodness for the long walk. Yes, Hal.
Remind me of a book a long time ago, it's called The Life of Archpriest Abakum.
Oh yeah, exactly that. It's the old believer philosophy.
It was a nice little stroll across Siberia. I mean, it was like it's very similar to Lewis and Clark and all that. It's not just walking, it's rivers, it's wolves, it's dangerous, it's lightning, it's forest fire, I mean, all kinds of things.
But he's blessing all of it as he goes.
Right.
Yeah. In fact, we had an encounter like that. We invited in Alaska the Metropolitan of Prague from Czechoslovakia, and we flew into a bear sanctuary where all the bears late in the summer were fishing. They're out in the river and catching fish. And that we were warned we had to go to an orientation at this park, this federal national park, first to watch a video on what to do in case you meet a bear. So, and then you got a little pin to prove that you'd gone through that orientation. So we all 20 of us had this little pin. And what do you know, coming back toward our flight home, toward the little craft that had landed on the lake, a park ranger came running down the staff, "Get off the path, there's a bear coming right down the path." And the bears owned the place, right? So everybody got into the woods as fast as we could. The last one off the path was the Metropolitan. And the bear came down the path, like coming up those steps, and stopped right there and looked at him. And he just froze, because all of us did, and we're looking at the bear. And the bear then looked, and went back down on all fours and continued. We rushed over to him, "Your Beatitude, what did you do when the bear stopped and looked right at you?" He said, "I blessed it." and the bear continued on his way. but there's this kind of harmony with nature. "I blessed it," yeah. There's a story of Father Juvenali before he died. He's standing up on the bow of the canoe where he was traveling. And the story is, the people remember 2 centuries later, before he died, it looked to them on the beach like he was trying to chase away flies. But again, what was he doing? The people had their arrows pointed right at him, that he's about to die, and any second the arrows are going to strike. He was blessing them, and he was doing it fast. So 200 years later, it's still remembered that way as chasing away flies. Now, that's a detail that you know those people were eyewitnesses. That's exactly how it looked to those Alaskan native hunters, right? Because they still haven't figured it out that he was making the sign of the cross very quickly. And so they still remembered to this day, as the story is told, as chasing away flies.
It's like the same as Seraphim
Sarovsky. Exactly.
In the forest.
Exactly. 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 So.
Making sense to this exhibition, because when you try to explain the spiritual legacy of the Native American people, you need an expert, and Father is that. I can recall when I was in the Klutna in all those years, I had the privilege of knowing Mike Alex, Shem Pete, the
wow. Stephans, these are the elders of the 20th century.
Shem Pete, when we would have no priests, Father Nicholas would go to Chignik Lake, and we would have to have the burial. So we couldn't call a priest, and Father Skolka wasn't available, and we would say prayers. And Shem Pete, being the chief of the Athabascas, the Dena'ina
people,
the last one, he would insist that it be the way it always was. And the younger boys in the village and people would argue with him, and all he would say is something in Dena'ina, and they would all stay quiet, and it would be done that Shem Pete's way. In one case, it was an icon. Should it face the altar on the casket, or should it face the people? And in the midst of the singing of the hymns, he stopped the whole thing and says, and he came over to the casket, and he moved it so that the icon would face the face of the departed person. And the whole village, just from then on, that's our rules. And if you remember the Stephans and the Izais, those families, they were all basically descendants of shamans who kept the faith going in these areas. So, Father, on behalf of the Museum of the Orthodox Church in America, which is in possession of many of our articles, we'd like to present you these relics of the Moravian Saint Goraz of Prague.
Oh, yes.
And I don't know if you have these relics.
No.
You know he's amongst the people of Moravia, Bohemia, and Czech and Slovak lands. He is someone who was martyred for our faith during World War II.
Yes, yes.
When he was tried and, of course, executed. So please, on behalf of the museum,
Holy
please
Saint Goraz, pray
take
the
these back to you. And
thank you so much.
Matushka? Matushka, you have been the inspiration for your husband all these years, from Quetzalcoatl. And I remember we had students in St. Herman's from her village. There was the Nushaga, the Kuskokwim, the Yukon. But Matushka, you deserve something to wear for Pascha. So please accept this as a gift from us for inspiring your husband, teaching him about the Yupik people.
Thank you.
God bless you. Father.
And again, this is just a little something from all of us.
Oh, my.
A little something to remember Villanova by in the box. And then
When you open it, you'll be the only priest in Alaska with a Villanova piece on the day after they won the
national championship.
Which is the reason why there are so many seats empty, but this is going throughout on YouTube, and I'm sure people will enjoy it. But Father, I thank you.
Thank you so much, Father John.
God bless you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Father. Well, as a Georgetown graduate, highly conscious of the fact that the last time Villanova won the national championship, it was at our expense. I'm happy to congratulate Villanova today on their victory over North Carolina. It was really one of the most amazing athletic performances we've seen in many, many years, maybe ever on the basketball court. It was really quite tremendous, thanks be to God.
Father, before you leave, can you just sing in Yupik the Chopar for the cross?
Oh, boy. Okay. I think I translated it at one time.
Or is the St. Herman Chopar, either or.
Well, St. Herman Chopar is even easier, and it's more even more appropriate because we have his icon here. Nunat nikalak famagia gaivia Christusam Choligakluki utkili manga yukavia nun Lit narista chali apustalak pichul ramakuk falak Gaigal rachali gaiuktit pistail ngut Gnug na pichul rima gayu im America mi Nan ramal rata kermel ag Alaska mi A gayus gut waspadam nun Isus Christus amun Anik tux kluku anag na put huang kutam